Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. A video has been released showing Louisiana police officers murdering a restrained black man. And so far, we have no clear answers as to why this man was even targeted by the police. The Koch brothers have been strangely silent in this election cycle. Or have they? They're going to spend almost $1 billion. They're just doing it where we aren't paying attention. And Scott Walker can't stop ruining the state of Wisconsin. We'll bring you the details in tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
How stupid are the people of the country?
And maybe I'll be a little bit unpresidential.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flag.
We regret these errors and apologize. We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Before we begin tonight, I wanted to take a few minutes to make a special announcement here. On August 1st, Ring of Fire on Free Speech TV will be coming to an end. This is not anything to do with the network or anything to do with us here at Ring of Fire, really. We're going to continue doing what we do every day, interviews, news stories, and they will be posted on our YouTube channel. It's just that, unfortunately, we're unable to continue operating with the network. Again, this has nothing to do with Free Speech TV. We have enjoyed our time here. We love everyone at the network. They've been phenomenal to work with. The reality is that it costs a lot of money to produce and put a TV show out every single day. Licensing fees that you have to pay to be on the air. And so we as a business had to weigh those expenses versus other opportunities. And so we have decided to move the show to a strictly online-only format, which you'll be able to find every day on our YouTube channel and on our website, theringoffire.com. We will continue to support the Free Speech TV network in any way that we can. We have made a lot of great friends over there. We fully support everything that they do. And I want to make it clear that this has nothing to do with any hard feelings whatsoever towards the Free Speech TV network. It, like most decisions, is a financial one. We have to put our resources where we can use them best. And unfortunately, right now, that's not continuing on with Free Speech TV. Again, it costs a lot of money to do that. And it's a lot of work here for all of us. And we do have several other really big projects, really big announcements coming up in the next few months. So please check back on our website, theringoffire.com. We'll be posting videos on YouTube about it. But the most important thing to know is that we are not going to stop what we do. We're going to be producing video content every single day. In fact, we're going to be producing more than we produce now. You can find it on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftv. Again, every video will be posted on our website. And we want you to check all day, every day, because we will be commenting real time on things in politics and legal news as they happen. And again, we will continue to support Free Speech TV in any way that we can. We are incredibly grateful for the opportunity that the network has given us, and we wish them the best, and I know they wish us the best. And please don't think that there is anything, you know, any sour feelings between the two entities of Ring of Fire and Free Speech TV, because there absolutely is not. We just had to make a choice, and so we made it. Moving on to other news tonight. Earlier this week, allegedly unarmed black man in the state of Louisiana, in the city of Baton Rouge, was murdered by two police officers. What we know so far is that these police officers were called to the scene because some anonymous person called 911 saying that this man had a gun. We do not know at the moment if he did have a gun on him or not. We do not know that he was threatening anyone. We don't know if he did have a gun. Did he have a permit? Did he have a concealed weapons permit? Was he allowed to carry the gun? All we know is that it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because this man, Alton Sterling, is dead. because the two police officers that responded on the scene killed him. The video clearly shows that the police had him restrained. They tackled him to the ground, put a gun to the back of his head, and shot him. He was completely restrained. He wasn't screaming, "I'm going to kill you." He wasn't threatening them. He didn't have a weapon in his hands. Nothing. And the police just killed him. This is a prime example as why the Black Lives Matter movement is so important, because things like this are still happening and nothing is being done about it. In fact, the state of Louisiana recently actually passed a law that made any crime against a police officer categorized as a hate crime. So that's great. Yeah, we need to protect police officers. We absolutely do. Brave men and women out there every day, you know, putting their lives on the line to keep us safe. But we need to hold them accountable when they flat out murder someone. And that is what happened. That video is unequivocal. We can see what happened there. Now, maybe we'll find out in the days to come, maybe he was muttering something under his breath about how he was going to kill them. That's incredibly unlikely, and it's not going to happen. But since we don't know, all we can base our opinions on is what we see in that video. And we see two white police officers force this man to the ground and kill him. When's it going to stop? What do we have to do to make things like this stop? And this is not the first time we have seen a video like this. I mean, the cops may not be wearing body cameras, but people have cell phones and they're starting to capture these things on video. The two officers involved had been suspended as per protocol of the police station, but they'll be back. And if they're not back at that police station, they'll just go to another one. At this point, at the time of this filming, we don't even know their names. They could go anywhere and just continue the cycle of killing because they don't know any better. Because they wanted to be cops because they had something to prove. They wanted to be the tough guys, go out there and take down the scumbags. This man, Alton Sterling, father of five, is dead. For no reason. There is no reason why this man should be dead. We don't even know that he committed a crime. We'll never know if he intended to commit a crime, because the police didn't even bother to ask him a question. They did what white police officers in this country too often do. And they just decided, you know what? We're going to kill this black man. And that's unacceptable. Something has to change. And unfortunately, I don't have any answers as to what can change. How do we stop this? Can we start screening police officers for racist leanings? I don't know how you would do that, but I'd be all for it if we can find a way, because we can't continue on like this as a country. This is a uniquely American problem. Something's wrong with us as a country. And a lot of people just choose to believe that everything is fine. There's going to be stories. Fox News will be leading the charge. In fact, they already are, about how scary this guy was and how terrifying he looked. And how, yeah, he probably had a criminal record. Ooh, so he should die. There's no reason why Alton Sterling should be dead today. But he is. Because of poor judgment, poor training from those two Baton Rouge police officers. In other news today, Scott Walker, Republican governor of Wisconsin, Koch brothers' favorite politician and failed Republican presidential candidate, is continuing to destroy the great state of Wisconsin. Now, when he first came into office, he enacted massive tax cuts for the top 1%. In fact, 78% of those tax cuts went to people making more than $1 million a year. Now, the idea, as usual with all Republican economics, was that if we cut taxes for the top 1% in Wisconsin, they're going to turn around and invest that money right back into the state. And therefore, we're going to have job growth. We're going to have a stimulated economy. Everything in the state of Wisconsin is going to be great because we gave more money to millionaires. That's what Scott Walker sold when he ran for election, because that's what the Koch brothers told him to sell. And as it turns out, reports are showing us now, no, the state of Wisconsin is doing pretty bad compared to the rest of the country. Job growth in the state of Wisconsin is below the national average. A wage gap, just as big, if not bigger, than national average. We're looking at a state whose economic growth is well below the economic growth of the country as a whole, and it is because the tax breaks that Scott Walker gave to the top 1%. Because that money is not going back into the Wisconsin economy. It's going into banks. It's going into trust funds. It's going to buy yachts and second homes down in Florida or California. It's not going into Wisconsin. Do you know why? Because trickle-down economics has never worked and it will never work. And even David Stockman, the man who invented trickle-down economics, says, yeah, it was a stupid idea. And in practice, there is no practical way that it could ever work. And that's from the guy who invented it. But you know what? Republicans like Scott Walker and Sam Brownback, what he did to Kansas, they will never stop this because they don't actually care about economic growth. What they care about is giving handouts to the wealthy 1%, because that 1% is going to turn right back around and give it to the Republican politicians. And that's why they're going to continue to do it, even though they know that it will never, ever work. And finally today, earlier this week, the FBI made the announcement that, yes, Hillary Clinton acted carelessly, irresponsibly, in the handling of her emails, but they do not recommend that the Department of Justice pursue any criminal charges against Hillary Clinton. Now, let's make clear. James Comey, director of the FBI, said that it is their recommendation to the Department of Justice that the DOJ does not pursue criminal charges against her. A lot of the Hillary Clinton supporters have said that this means there are no charges. There are no charges right now. The DOJ could absolutely bring them. Now, I'm going to say something that could likely lose me a lot of fans and followers here, but I agree with the DOJ in that there should not be any criminal charges filed against Hillary Clinton. That is a position I have maintained throughout this entire alleged email scandal. This has been a distraction. It has been a witch hunt by the Republican Party. And look at how the Republicans are all reacting right now. They're saying, oh, the system is rigged. Obama did something to help Hillary out. Or Loretta Lynch, in her secret little meeting with Bill Clinton, did something to help Hillary out here. That's not what happened. What happened is that any reasonable person who looked at this can see that Hillary Clinton might have done things that are pretty stupid, and she did, but there was no criminal intent to it. You know, the Republicans seem to miss that. There was no criminal intent here. They tell you where there was criminal intent regarding emails is when Karl Rove was using White House computers to actively campaign for George W. Bush, a direct violation of the Hatch Act. That was illegal, and there were no criminal charges. Or Colin Powell's email problems and Dick Cheney's, you know, with the whole Iraq yellow cake thing. Those were criminal intentions, but Republicans never batted an eye, and liberals reported it for a day or two and said, ho-hum, let's move on. So you know what? From this whole Hillary Clinton email scandal, everybody take a deep breath and move on, because it's over and it needs to be over so we can focus on the issues. I have a lot of problems with Hillary Clinton, but her not knowing email servers and how to properly use computers isn't one of them. The Koch brothers announced months ago that they were going to spend close to $1 billion in this year's elections. And we know that they aren't giving that money to Donald Trump. So where is that money going? Joining me now to answer that question is Howard Nations. So Howard, a long time ago, the Koch brothers said, look, we're going to spend almost $1 billion in this year's election. We had Karl Rove and his little crossroads group. They were going to come out and be big spenders in this election. Adelson, all the usual suspects. They had such high hopes for this year's election. And then suddenly nothing. Everybody seems to have disappeared off the face of the earth. And, you know, Trump has just kind of taken over. Koch brothers, Rove, Adelson, all those guys are seemingly quiet at the moment. What's your take on this?
Well, Rove and Adelson were tweeted to death by Donald Trump. But the Koch brothers are still very much alive and well and working their magic. The Koch brothers are omnipresent, but they're under the radar. When you see the do-nothing House of Representatives, that's the Koch brothers. When you see legislative races, state attorney general races, congressional races, that's the Koch brothers. They're still the most powerful single force in the Republican Party. And they manage that as well as anything else through the American Legislative Exchange Council, which carries out the Koch brothers' legislative agenda. If you look at it, what the Koch brothers want on the environment, they want no penalties, no regulations, no legislation to stop pollution because they're one of the three largest polluters in the United States. They want privatization of public schools. They want to rewrite the history books as they have in Texas to reflect their father's John Birch Society philosophy. They want non-regulation of the financial industry, union busting as they've done in Wisconsin, especially public employee unions and teachers unions. They oppose the minimum wage. They want no taxation of the upper 1%, and they want to handpick and elect the president. Now, 10 out of 11 is not bad. Their only failure has been the presidential politics. It may have something to do with their quality of their candidates. They backed Herman Cain, Rick Perry, Michelle Bachmann, and in 2016, their big guy was Scott Walker, where they invested $10 million in his recall election and had him teed up for the presidential race, and he fell flat in the presidential race, another victim of Trump.
So. Well, you know, it's interesting that their guy Walker got trounced so bad nationally. I mean, he was one of the first people to drop out, even though he was never at the kids' table debates. He was always at the big boys' stage, but he still couldn't hack it. And so, you know, the Koch brothers, they're very quiet right now. You know, they about a year ago, they were doing all their little PR, talking about, well, you know, we're really the victims here. The 1% are so underrepresented in this country. And they tried to do that whole makeover thing. They sat down with Joe Scarborough and Micah Brzezinski, you know, trying to be like, we're the good guys. We want to do all these great things. But then they realized nobody bought it. So they said, they didn't say that we're going to back off of politics. They said we're going to go under the radar.
And they have.
And that's what we're seeing today.
They've had a very successful time since 2010. Their success is at the federal level. After 2 years of Obama, from 2008 to 2010, being highly successful, they seized control of the Congress in 2010 with the Tea Party Revolution. They put up $45 million into the 2010 Congress, and they stopped the Obama's legislative agenda in its tracks and have been stopped ever since. Obama's had to move to executive orders just because of that. On the state levels, where they're very highly active, they choose governors, attorneys general, state legislatures, and they pay attention to something very smart. They choose secretaries of state. And they control all this through the American Legislative Exchange Council, which drafts the Koch brothers' agenda into state laws. Then they give that to their state legislators, who carry those as bills, and they pass it. The Koch brothers' agenda becomes the law of the states all over the country. What do they got? 35 states that the Republicans are controlling. They also draft anti-voting legislation through ALEC. They suppress voter turnout. They have voter ID laws. And they target and reduce Democratic demographics. And here's where the Secretary of State's come in. The Secretaries of State control voting, the rules and regulations, the hours that polling places are open, how many polling places there are in each district. They understand that. And that is a major means of suppressing the vote. But their goal is to suppress minorities, college students, any demographic group that might be supporting Democrats, and they've been very successful.
And so what we're seeing now from the Kochs is the same thing we saw from them in 2014. They knew that they weren't going to have too much of an impact on the national elections, the senators and the House of Representatives. So what they did in 2014 was they took their fights to the states. They passed, tax ordinances in small towns in Ohio. They right. worked with the Dakotas to pass laws allowing more fracking. And those were things that at the time nobody paid attention to. We didn't know they were happening. It's very hard to track the money in state elections. But we found out after the fact. The Center for Media and Democracy did a great job of exposing all of this. And they're exposing all of it right now. The question is, why isn't anyone paying attention? We've seen them do this before. We've seen it be successful. And they're doing the same thing right now, except they're doing it with close to $1 billion. They've spent over $400 million at this point already. So why are we not paying more attention to this? I mean, as far as the National Democratic Party, they should be very concerned.
Well, this is where they are under the radar. It's the social welfare nonprofits. In 1999 to 2010, there were 1,551 social welfare nonprofits created in the United States. After 2010, when the Tea Party Revolution took over, 2010 to 2016, there have been 2,316 nonprofits added. That's 150% increase in 6 years. Why? Citizens United, dark money. Social nonprofits, they make no donor disclosures. They don't identify where the money comes from. And they're controlled by rules that they're allegedly supposed to spend only half of their money on politics. But as a result, you recall in 2012, the IRS, the audit division was attacked as targeting conservative nonprofits. Well, that's what they're supposed to do. They're supposed to attack and to target all nonprofits to make sure that they're spending in accordance with the rules that make them nonprofits. And that was their reason for existing. Republican politicians attacked the IRS, threatened to cut off their budget if they kept it up, so the IRS backed off. So now these social network groups, which are nonprofits, are no longer audited by the IRS. The result is in 2012, that very year when they backed off, the social network groups spent $257 million on federal elections alone. And now their latest thing is, and this is the Koch brothers, the social networks have increased greatly in the South. Because it's in the South, their agenda is easier because they have a lot of people who are already preconditioned for the same type of agenda that they are. So they're targeting states like Virginia, Texas, Florida, Georgia. Virginia and Florida are obviously presidential swing states. The other states are very big on voter suppression. North Carolina, Texas, huge on voter suppression. And so they're there, they're under the radar, and they're being extremely successful.
And I think it's important to point out as well, they're not only fighting for the presidential election, they're fighting for their own interests in each of those states. Oh, yeah. For example, in the state of Florida, we found out not too long ago that they actually fought an initiative that would have increased the amount of state investment into solar energy. I mean, we're talking about, something as simple as that. The Koch brothers helped to kill that just so they could continue to exploit, fossil fuels in the state of Florida. And they're doing this everywhere. They're heavily involved, obviously, in Texas and Oklahoma. They want to bring it to Virginia. They want to go back into Ohio with it. And so we're going to see a lot more of this. And again, my big concern here is that the Democratic Party itself is not out there fighting this. And to be honest, I don't know that they can. I don't know that we can fight close to $1 billion of outside money that's being funneled, almost laundered through these nonprofit organizations that are clearly violating the law, yet they can't do anything about it. It almost seems at this point like we got to sit back and accept it. I mean, it's a terrifying reality, but this is what's happening. And I don't have any answers.
Yeah, but let me give you a quick, easy history lesson. 2012, they spent close to $1 billion, and their major target was to defeat Obama. So that it can happen. They lost hundreds of millions of dollars. Rove lost hundreds of millions of dollars. Adelson, they all lost big time. Now, they won in the states, and that's their big deal. So right now what they're doing, their new deal is they've carefully targeted and funded individual groups. For example, how many Democrats have ever heard of Libra, L-I-B-R-E, Libra? Libra is a nonprofit targeting Latino voters. It opposes Obamacare, opposes federal minimum wage. Now, you know Latinos want to oppose federal minimum wage, right? It supports market-based immigration. Market-based means it's okay for the Mexicans to come in and do all the things they do here that the white Americans don't want to do, as long as they go back home when they're through. The YEM, how many have heard of the YEM? The YEM is a group, a generation opportunity, they call it. It's a Koch group that targets millennials. They want to oppose government regulation. They oppose the national debt increase. They oppose the minimum wage. You know millennials want to oppose the minimum wage, right? They oppose Obamacare. You know millennials want to do that. They have another group called Public Notice, opposing government spending, opposing government regulation. They have another group they back called Christians Trust, which is socially conservative. It's anti-LGBT. Another group they back is one of their nonprofits, Center for American Opportunity, limited government. And then, of course, they have their Tea Party Patriots, which is all about presidential elections. And once again, these guys seem to do everything right except pick presidential candidates. This year, they packed the Tea Party Patriots backed Ted Cruz. So, I mean, they're there, they're everywhere. They got all these nonprofits operating, they're targeted nonprofits. And those things I just listed, opposing all those things I just listed, all of those are the Koch brothers' agenda. And they're trying to convince the Latinos that it's their agenda, the young that it's their agenda, the Christians, it is the Christian agenda for the most part. But the Koch brothers understand one thing about politicians better than anybody else. Politicians are concerned about three things. One is reelection. A lot of them are concerned, secondly, about getting a higher office. If you're in the state legislature, you want to go to the Congress. If you're in the Congress, you want to go to the Senate, and so forth. But third, they also want a profitable soft landing. So if they get defeated for reelection and you're a Koch candidate, you're hired as a lobbyist, and that's a nice little plush retirement fund. So they do it, they understand it, and you got to give them credit. I mean, it's evil, but it's working.
It is, and unfortunately, you do. They play the game better than anyone else. Unfortunately, every time they win, it means the rest of us are the losers. And so, you know, education right now is our greatest weapon. Yeah, we're out here, we're talking about this. I mean, you know so much about this, and we appreciate you telling us these stories today. So we will keep on it. We got to fight back. This is a huge election year, and there is a lot more at stake than just the presidency. The Koch brothers understand it, and I think the Democratic Party needs to understand that as well. So, Howard, thank you very much for talking with us today.
My pleasure, Farron. Thanks.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website, theringoffire.com. You can get our daily podcast by going online to rofpodcast.com, and you can subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftv. You can follow me on Twitter at Farron Balance, and you can follow the show at Ring of Fire Radio, and make sure you tune into Ring of Fire Radio this Saturday, 3 p.m. Eastern. You can listen live on progressivevoices.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and thanks for watching.